I appreciate your prayers. This has been a very long and exhausting journey. I'm almost done. I've got about 5 more months left. So I'm hoping by March I will be completely done with the classes, the internship, the mentoring meetings, and all this other stuff, and I can put it behind me and really dig into what God's calling me to do, whatnot. So, but I appreciate your prayers for me and for my family, even though I always say that my family needs prayers because I'm their dad. And I'm Heather's husband. She'd probably be sitting there going, yeah. So we are open with a word of prayer. So Father, we thank you for tonight. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to come into your house. Lord, as I stand here before your children, Father, I ask that that you use my mind and my voice to speak to whatever you want them to hear tonight, Father. If there's anybody here that needs to hear this, that you open up their hearts, they open up their minds, Father. That I do, I put myself aside and I surrender to your will. I give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. Ever since I started doing this, had the opportunity to do this, I've always made sure that I've always been sensitive to what God's doing by praying, reading his word, talking with pastor, talking with other elders in the church, letting them know, hey, well, this is what I'm feeling, mainly for prayer, for guidance. Tonight is a little bit different than what I'm actually used to. Kind of prefer to preach on how good God is and the miracles that he performs and the love of God and how faithful he is and all this stuff. But as I was praying for this and studying for it, I kind of noticed that my path was going a little bit different. And it's been confirmed by a few people by talking to them in prayer and giving ideas and notes and sharing that everything seems to be kind of coming together. My number one priority is to follow the leading of what God is wanting me to do. So we'll go ahead and we'll get started. I use the English Standard Version. If you have your Bibles or your smart devices or anything like that, please feel free. I like the ESV version because it's basically the King James into today's language. But I do use NASB. I wish I could get my hands on the Bible that you and Darren have gone. When I used that one time recently, I just absolutely fell in love with it because the reference verses are right there. You don't have to go bottom page or in the center or anything like that. So, but I use different versions, but I like using the ESV. I was introduced to that a few years ago by another pastor from another church at one of my ASIM classes, and I just seemed to enjoy using it. So the text tonight is going to be... the title is going to be Real Christianity, and I've kind of hem-hauled around a little bit on a few different titles, but this one just seems to fit. So we'll go to Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 through 21. I'll give you a minute or two to get there. So it says, So I say walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissension, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God.
Amen.
I'm just going to throw in Revelations 21:8. Our main text is going to be in Galatians, but Revelations 21:8. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for the murderers, the sexual immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. I would prefer the first death because I know I'm going to God.
Come on.
The second death I'm not interested in. I want the first death. That means then I go as far as I can spend time with Jesus, running around the streets of gold and see my grandmother again and just kick back on the side of the beach and watch the birds fly around and just have a good old time. That second death is something I'm really not interested in. Because that's where we're gonna be like, oh my gosh, I wish I would have listened to that pastor on that Sunday morning. Or I wish I would have listened to that street evangelist on that Friday night. So it says, as the world gets older and society progresses, Christianity seems to slowly be replaced with, by a misconstrued version of Christianity. These new so-called Christians feel that if they go to church on Sundays, Bible studies on Wednesday nights, that's all they need to do. So they continue to drink, smoke, do drugs, whatever. I know of some that will actually witness to somebody or post a Bible scripture on social media, then turn right around and open a beer, post a picture of them drinking in a bar on the same social media website, light a cigarette, or even witness to somebody while smoking, or even to the point of almost being drunk. I personally had somebody witness to me many years ago on how good God is and how much God has increased their business, all while being intoxicated. And he had a drink in his hand. Now, I wasn't in church back then, but it still bothered me because, I grew up in church. And I knew there's this such thing as called leadership by example. If you're going to tell somebody how good God is, then you need to be the example. It's almost like somebody telling you, like a doctor telling you need to stop smoking and he's got a cigarette in his hand. So, he was a really good example. And he's actually a family member of mine. So society, in fact, is promoting that even it's okay to be a homosexual or a lesbian. They can even be a born-again Christian. You believe that? There's even churches out there that allow homosexuals and lesbians to come and worship in their service, just like we do here at Buckeye First Assembly. That's their norm. In fact, the pastor may even be a homosexual or lesbian themselves. These churches are not Bible-believing churches as they claim to be, or the pastor would not live that type of lifestyle. So don't get me wrong, we should be allowing them to come into church without no judgment. They're already judged. We are not the ones to pass judgment on anybody. Matthew 7:1-3. We are to love them as Jesus does. Teach them that it's wrong to live this type of lifestyle. Help them to come to repentance.
Amen.
Before they would possibly hold any type of leadership in the church, if any. I mean, the Bible just says, Leviticus 18:22, this is actually an abomination. So love the sinner, hate the sin.
That's it.
I've heard that a lot of times, love the sinner and hate the sin. God loves a sinner, no matter what.
Yes,
amen.
So society is even trying to push Islam, saying that certain things are okay, or we need to accept the way things are becoming. So I'm here to tell you that none of this is right. All this is not anywhere close to being a real Christian. Christianity began when Jesus called his disciples and began to preach around AD 27, 29. But it wasn't until AD 30, 32 that Jesus' followers were beginning to be called Christians. Christianity has been around longer than Islam. Islam began around 600 AD, so Christianity wins in my book. It's been around longer. So point number one, being a real Christian means to lead by example. I first heard this phrase when I was in high school. I was in the ROTC program in high school, and the instructor was adamant about you earn what you get when you get promoted, how their promotions are. If you want something, you earn it, and then it's leadership by example. You lead by example. It's a definition of lead by example is good leaders must lead by example by walking their talk. Walk your walk, talk your talk. You become a person others want to follow. You don't push them to follow you. You don't demand they follow you. They want to be there to follow you. When leaders say one thing but do another, they erode trust, a critical element of productive leadership. In other words, don't have someone do something you're not willing to do yourself. And another good example is walk by the side of your team, not ahead of them. Work along with them. Encourage them. Not have them do all the work and you take all the credit. I've been around that, I can tell you. You're out there, blood, sweat, and tears, busted fingers, and somebody comes up and says, oh yeah, we did all this, and as far as I had, did all this. I was like, no. No, you need to recognize your team.
That's That's right.
That's how you rank, you earn the trust of the people, and that's how you get them to follow you, is to recognize them and give them the credit that they deserve. So point number two, don't be fake. Definition of authentic, or I'm sorry, don't be fake, be authentic. Definition of authentic in two words, be real. Christianity is a 24/7 lifestyle, not just a few hours a week. You live in a glass house on Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings and sometimes in between. Authenticity just so happens to be one of the church's core values here. Keep in mind, it can be difficult to spot a real Christian, though, over a fake one. Unless you want to get rich by selling miracle spring water. I'm sure that comes from a kitchen or a sink and gives somebody false hope. Then you're a real 100% true Christian. Not even close. If I would have known personally I could get rich on selling tap water to somebody and giving somebody false hope, I would have done it years ago. But I'm sure my conscience has gotten in the way. God got in the way.
All right. That's right.
That's it.
I see these advertisements on TV, and I can tell you I shake my head. I remember, I think I talked to Dale a while back. We were talking about this individual, and it's just, why God? Why are you allowing him to be on TV giving these people false hope? But he's going to have to answer for it someday.
That's it.
Sure.
And I would not want to be in his shoes. I remember not too long ago I was praying, and did get into a little self-pity potty of something that happened. I appreciate you, John, for that situation a few weeks ago, the multiple phone calls. God basically said, let me take vengeance on the ones that hurt my children.
Praise God.
That's it.
And I'm like, okay, you got it. All right, so point number three, we're gonna watch a video about I think about 3 minutes, a little over 3 minutes. Like you to pay attention to some of the things that are actually going on in the video, and they'll kind of correspond with the next part of this.
Like the Red Sea, when that old
The Crabb family, they've been around for a while, and it was Jason Crabb, multi-winning Grammy and Dove Award winners, and I kind of started getting the idea for this after just randomly seeing that video on YouTube. For some reason, that started the whole thing. So, point number three is don't be judgmental. As mentioned earlier, we are not to judge. My grandmother always told me growing up that you should never point your finger at somebody because you have three pointing right back at you. Right? To sum that up, you are no better than anyone. God is no respecter of persons, Acts 10:34. I've heard numerous times that people don't want to come to church because they say Christians are or can be judgmental. Even my own cousin Jim in conversation says the same thing. I've been praying for his salvation and his family's salvation. I do agree with him to a point because I have witnessed this and even possibly guilty of this myself. And it's not just the newer Christians, the ones who probably don't really know better. It's even the seasoned ones, the ones that should know better, that can do this. Everyone has a story, has a past. If anyone who is in Christ, they are a new creation. 2 Corinthians 5:17, and that should be all that matters. I was actually told by somebody in the church not too long after Heather and I became members about 6 years ago that they were standoffish to us at first because of not knowing who we are, what we were about as far as our intentions. And I get that, but don't you think that could even be a little partially judgmental as well? Why not approach the person, be guarded, obviously, you know, and start to get to know them, as opposed to waiting, you know, days or weeks or anything like that, just to take a seat, get the feel of them. Because you've seen that one gentleman in there, you know, he's hurting because he just lost his family. And nobody wants to come and talk to him, you know, to comfort him, to let him know that it's okay to hurt, that God's there. Not only do people judge others, but the church in itself has also gotten to the point of being judgmental in a sense. And I'm not talking about an AG church or a Baptist church or a Catholic church or a Mormon church. I'm talking about the church in general. So for example, we'll take a look at a couple of pictures. In picture one, how many in the church would actually come and embrace somebody like this? But in fact, they would jump at the ones in picture number two. Because there's little to no work involved. If you look at picture number one and then picture number two, there's no dirt. But in all actuality, when you look at picture number two, they can have more dirt than the one person in picture number one. The gentleman in picture number one could be as real, as even more real than those in this picture right here. When in fact, we need to be like picture number three. Yeah. And picture number four. That's a California Highway Patrol officer praying for homeless. If you can't really tell. Sorry, I tried to get a better picture of it, but I couldn't find a clear picture. And also, by the way, that officer also received disciplinary action for doing this. And yes, we as Christians can't be persecuted for what we believe and do. We are in a day and age where we must watch our back. Because what we feel is right, somebody is going to say it's wrong.
It's true.
That's right.
So I'll read a little story that I pulled up on that one picture real quick. It says, California Highway Patrol, Golden Gate Division, praying and handing out lunches. They were praying and handing out lunches to the homeless. today with El Protector Officer Custodio Lopez and Public Information Officer John Franzen in Action with Compassion. Thank you to the Oakland Merchants Association, OMA, and to the CHP officers for buying the meals. They bought the meals for these people. But despite their kindness, generosity, and genuine concern for the homeless men and women in their communities, these officers are now facing backlash for displaying their faith while on the clock. The American Humanist Association, I've been trying to figure out how to say this person's name, Apignani, Humanist Legal Center, issued a press release warning that the officer's prayer while on duty violated the establishment of religious clause in the First Amendment. The statement, highway patrol officers proselytizing on the job, in addition to advertising such activities on social media, clearly endorses religion, thus violating the state and federal constitutions. Monica Miller, a lawyer for the group, said in the release, numerous citizens and taxpayers object to this religious promotion, and we insist that the California Highway Patrol prevent future incidents like this one. Roy Spechthart, executive director of the American Humanist Association, added, law enforcement has a duty to protect, not convert.
Okay. Alrighty.
So what if he converts them? If he converts them, who cares? That's their choice. We're told to plant the seed, let God deal with it.
That's
like, right. That's all he's doing is planting a seed. He's not telling them you have to become a Christian. You know, or you're going to go to hell. He's just there to show them the love of Christ.
Amen.
When officers leave prayer on duty, they send an intimidating message to non-religious citizens who may feel pressured to participate in religion and may feel unsafe in their own communities. Matthew 5:10. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
That's your name.
I read that story and I was like, really? Come on, people. You know, we're just out there to try to make a difference. We're just out there trying to love people. And the ones that are out there that he's praying for, can you imagine? They're standing there accepting the prayer and not out there killing anybody.
Yeah.
Raping somebody. You know, causing the police officers to have to chase after them. That's what they're doing. Is they're just trying to make a difference. That's why some people become police officers. My one cousin is a police officer for the city of Avondale, and he's out there doing what he's doing because he wants to be that 0.1% of a difference. So as we see here in these pictures, this is almost how the church has become. It prefers this over this when we actually need to be doing this. The church has gotten to the point that it doesn't want to get its hands dirty. We are to get our hands dirty without
Amen.
Thinking twice about
That's
it.
It. That's
and I'm not talking about going out and digging holes
right.
or trimming trees, you know, or cleaning the church or cleaning anything like that. We are actually out there to get our hands dirty. Jesus got dirty.
That's right.
He spit in the dirt and made mud. Molded it in his hands. Put it on somebody's eyes. Healed his eyes. John 9:6. And he even healed a leper by touching him. Matthew 8:1-4. He got dirty. We need to get dirty too. So how can we make sure that we are being the example of a real Christian? So point number four, and I know Jana's going to like this one because I know this is her favorite verse. 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land.
Amen.
So I'm not saying every time that you pray, you're turning from a wicked attitude or behavior. What I'm saying is we must maintain a humbled attitude and a strong prayer life.
Amen.
Yes.
Maintaining a humbled attitude will you will not grow bitter and give in to the desires of the flesh. And keeping a strong prayer life will help you keep your spirit in control over your flesh.
Amen.
Point number five. I got like 6 or 7 points here. So point number five says, love the life God has given you.
All right.
Don't try to be like somebody else. well, you know, if I could have done this, or God could have let me be this person, be the one who God gave, can, you know, made you to be.
That's right.
Yeah, love the life that God has given you. Matthew 22:39, you shall love your neighbor as yourself.
That's right.
Ephesians 5:29, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church.
Yes.
You know, God, Jesus loves the church, right?
Amen.
It's nice to know that, you know, he's coming back for us.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
We're going to walk on the streets of gold.
Yeah.
And I'm going to sleep on the beach.
I want to go find trees.
And I'm not talking about being in love with yourself. I've been around people who think they're God's gift.
Yes.
Thinking you're God's gift to whomever. Or you think you might be better than somebody else.
Amen.
If you think that, then you better get on your face before God.
Amen.
I'm talking about loving yourself the way that Jesus does.
Yes, sir.
Knowing who you are in Christ. Living an abundant life, John 10:10.
Right.
There should in no way be somebody trying to be a true example of Christianity if they are downhearted, have low self-esteem, and have just a poor attitude.
Yeah.
It's not setting a very good example. Oh, God this and God that. You're going to have people run right out of this church. So point number 6. So Matthew 5:43-45, you have heard that it is said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and the unjust. I recall a conversation I had with Pastor Keith a few months ago. You may or may not remember this. We can talk about it later. But the topic was praying for somebody who came against you. This was after a men's prayer meeting a few months ago, I think, when you were either coming back from vacation when Nick and Taylor were here, or your guys were getting ready to go on vacation. But like I said, the topic was praying for those that come against you. It is extremely hard to pray for somebody who's hurt you. And I'm personally a witness to that. It is hard for me to pray for somebody who's hurt me. Because the one thing I'm going to want to do is, I ain't going to pray for him or her. But in all actuality, they might need prayer.
Yeah.
But a real Christian knows how important it is to do so, no matter how hard it is. We are to forgive and forget and move on. Jesus prayed and forgave those that beat and crucified him.
Yeah.
Luke 23:34, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Okay.
God will not forgive our debts if we don't forgive others.
Okay.
Matthew 6:12, forgive us our debts as we also forgive our debtors.
Yes.
This also goes for gossip. Gossip needs to stop before it even starts.
Come on.
Yeah. Yep. Amen.
Gossip needs to stop before it even starts. Before it even becomes a thought, it doesn't even need to be a thought. I said, if there's an issue with somebody, you take it to an accountability partner, or say a spiritual parent, and I love Dale and Larry. I appreciate you guys so much. I talk to them regularly and ask for perfect guidance on different things. Am I looking at something right? Or this is how I feel. Can you enlighten me? Pray, you know, as far as Tatum, Spencer, Heather, just, and when you go to their house, you know God's there.
Mm-hmm.
So you walk in the door, you can just feel the presence of God in their house.
Mm-hmm.
They don't do anything unless they prayed about it. And that's what I love about them. And that's why I always call on them for guidance and to talk and all that stuff. I also have another accountability partner, my sister-in-law, Carol, that lives in Michigan. I talk to her regularly too. She's very grounded in her faith, and I like to have her out of this, out of state as far as for certain reasons. But I talk to Dale and Larry, and I talk to her regularly, because they're, I guess they're elders and parents. The example that I need to be hooked up to, as far as that, I need to have, there, as far as an example. When you go to this individual, or these individuals, don't give out any names. Don't say, well, this person this, and this person that. Go to them and tell them what the situation is. Ask for prayer. Because once you actually start giving somebody a name that might not even know who this person is, you're having them draw up a conclusion of that person. And that person might not even, you know, may either said or done something wrong, not even realize it. But now you've just painted a picture of somebody to the person you're talking to, or talking about, somebody who doesn't even know. So if they actually even come and meet this person, they're already going to have as far as a mental picture of this person. And that's not right. So Ephesians 4:29, let no corrupt talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it might give grace to those who hear. Yeah. And I'm going to close. Being a solid Christian is not only important to those around you and to those you may inspire, but it's also important to you as well. So stay obedient to your calling by maintaining a strong prayer life, and stay strong in God's word, in addition with being by the fruit of the Spirit, is love, joy, peace, forbearance, or patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against there's no such law. I thank you for coming tonight. I pray everybody gets home safely, and I look forward to seeing you guys on Sunday morning.
Thank you, Darren, for sharing and for preparing the meal tonight, because I think that's what happens when we look to God's word. We break the bread of life. So thank you for that, and I thought you did a really good job of finding that balance on sometimes when it's something that is not palatable to share, or that's a little difficult. That can be one of the most difficult things as a minister, when you're praying, seeking God, and you're following His guidance and direction. But I thought you did a great job of just showing that, you know, the continual struggle for us as a church family is to try to find that balance on how to demonstrate biblical truth and to stand for godly values, while at the same exact time saying we accept and love every single person, no matter where they are, from what background. And that's the challenge. See, because all around the room, all of us are at different phases in our growth journey, every one of us. I've been growing in Christ. Well, I got saved when I was age 7, so I've been growing 44 years, and I think that sometimes I think I'm grown up, and then some days I think, man, I don't know a thing. Any of you can relate to that. So God is so faithful. But let's just close with prayer. Thanks again, dear. And Heavenly Father, thank you for your holy word. I just speak an Ephesians 4:29 blessing over all of us to be able to speak wholesome words and encouragement to each other always. That Matthew 7:7 thing of not judging one another, but by the same token, presenting ourselves to the established leadership in a way that is respectful and honoring. And thank you for our church family. Lord, I love Buckeye First Assembly. We're so blessed with the gift of one another. Help us in our growth to really be stretched and to get closer to you all the time. And as we're doing that, to get closer to one another too at the same time. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. And God bless all of you. If there